ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकया चक्षुर्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्ट्यं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपकदा मह्यं ददाति सपदान्तिकम्। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरुश्रीयुतपदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथान्वितं त्वां सजीवं स्वाद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्णकरुणासिन्धो दीनबन्धो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिकाकान्त्या राधाकान्त नमस्ते। तप्तकाञ्चन गौराङ्गी राधे वृन्दावनेश्वरी वृखवानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। वंशाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्येव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधर शिवासादि गौरभक्त वृन्द हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे। इंट्रोडक्शन टू गीतोपनिषद बाय ए सी भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी द ऑथर ऑफ श्रीमद् भागवतम इजी जर्नी टू अदर प्लैनेट्स एडिटर ऑफ बैक टू गॉड हेड एटसेट्रा। भगवद गीता इज नोन ऑल्सो गीतोपनिषद द एसेंस ऑफ वैदिक नॉलेज एंड वन ऑफ द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट ऑफ द वेरियस उपनिषद इन वैदिक लिटरेचर। दिस भगवद गीता there are many commentations in English, and what is the necessity of another English commentation of the Bhagavad Gita can be explained in the following way. One, one American lady, Mrs. Charlotte Devlin, asked me to recommend an English edition of Bhagavad Gita, which he can read. Of course, in America there are so many editions of English Bhagavad Gita, but so far I have seen that not only in America but also India, none of them can be said strictly as authoritative, because almost every one of them have expressed their own opinion through the commentation of the Bhagavad Gita without touching the spirit of Bhagavad Gita as it is. The spirit of Bhagavad Gita is mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita itself. It is just like this. If we want to take a particular medicine, then we have to follow the particular direction mentioned on the label of the medicine. We cannot take the particular medicine according to our own direction or by the direction of a friend, but we have to take the medicine under the direction given on the label of the bottle and as directed by the physician. Similarly, the Bhagavad Gita also should be taken or accepted as it is directed by the speaker himself. The speaker of the Bhagavad Gita is Lord Sri Krishna. He is mentioned in every page of the Bhagavad Gita as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Bhagavan. Of course, Bhagavan is sometimes designated to any powerful person or any powerful demigod. But here, Bhagavan is certainly designated to Sri Krishna, a great personality, but at the same time, we must know that Lord Sri Krishna, as he is confirmed by all the acharyas, I mean to say, even Shankaracharya, Ramanucharya, Madhyacharya, Nimbarkaswami, and Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and many others. In India, there were many authoritative scholars and acharyas, I mean authorities of the Vedic knowledge, all of them, including Shankaracharya, has accepted Sri Krishna as the Supreme Personality of God. The Lord Himself has also established himself as the Supreme Personality of Godhead in the Bhagavad Gita, he is accepted so in the Brahma Sanghita and all Puranas, especially in the Bhagavat Puranam, Krishnastu Bhagavan Sayam. So therefore, we should take Bhagavad Gita as it is directed by the Personality of Godhead Himself. So, in the fourth chapter of Bhagavad Gita, the Lord says, Imam vivasati yugam pratvaman aham abhayam vivasyan manave praha maru rikha kave bravit evam parampara praptam imam rajar sayo viduhu sakale neha mahata yugo nashta parantapa Saivayam mayati adhya yoga prakta puratanaha bhaktusi me sakhachiti rahasam jitat uttamam. The idea is, the Lord said to Arjuna that this yoga, this system of yoga, Bhagavad Gita, was first spoken by me to the sun god. And the sun god explained to Manu. Manu explained to Ikkhaku. And in that way, by disciplic succession, one after another, this yoga system is coming, and in course of time, this system is now lost, and therefore I am speaking to you the very same yoga system again, the very same old yoga system of Bhagavad Gita or Gita Upanishad. Because you are my devotee and you are my friend. Therefore, it is possible for you only to understand. Now the purpose is that Bhagavad Gita is a treatise which is specially meant for the devotee of the Lord. There are three classes of transcendentalists, namely the jnani, the yogi, and the bhakta, or the impersonalist, or the meditator, are the devotees. So here it is clearly mentioned, the Lord says to Arjuna that I am speaking or I am making you the first man of the parampara, because the old parampara or disciple succession is now broken. Therefore, I wish to establish again another parampara in the same line of thought as it was coming down from the sun god to others. So you take it and you distribute it, or the system, the yoga system of Bhagavad Gita may now be distributed through through you, you become the authority of understanding Bhagavad Gita. Now here is a direction that Bhagavad Gita is specially instructed to Arjuna, the devotee of the Lord, the direct student of Krishna. And not only that, he is intimately in touch with Krishna as friend. Therefore, Bhagavad Gita is understood by a person who has similar qualities like Krishna. That means he must be a devotee, he must be in relation, direct relationship with the Lord. As soon as one becomes a devotee of the Lord, he has a direct relationship also with the Lord. That is a subject matter very long, but briefly it can be stated that a devotee is in relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead in five ways. One may be a devotee in a passive state, one may be a devotee in active state, one may be a devotee as a friend, one may be a devotee as parent, and one may be a devotee as conjugal lover. So Arjuna was a devotee in relationship with the Lord as a friend. The Lord can become a friend. Of course, this friendship and the conception of friendship which you have got in the mundane world, there is a gulf of difference. This is transcendental friendship which not that everyone will have the relationship with the Lord. Everyone has got a particular relationship with the Lord, and that particular relationship is evoked by the perfection of devotional service. At the present status of our life, we have not only forgotten the Supreme Lord, but also we have forgotten our eternal relationship with the Lord. Every living being, out of many, many millions and billions of living beings, each and every living being has got a particular relationship with the Lord, eternally. That is called sarup. Sarup. And by the process of devotional service, one can revive that sarup of oneself. And that stage is called sarup siddhi, perfection of one's constitutional position. So Arjuna was a devotee and he was in touch with the Supreme Lord in a friendship. Now, this Bhagavad Gita was explained to Arjuna, and how Arjuna accepted it, that should also be noted. How Arjuna accepted the Bhagavad Gita is mentioned in the 10th chapter, just like Arjuna Uvacha. Param Brahma param dhama, pavitram paramam bhavan, purusam sasatam divyam adi deva ajam bihu. Ahustyam rishaya sarve devarsi naradastatha asita devala vyasa sayancheva bravisime. Sarvametat ritangamanne jat mang badasi kesava nahi te bhagavan bhaktin vidur deva nadanova. Now Arjuna says, after hearing Bhagavad Gita from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, he accepts Krishna as Param Brahma, the Supreme Brahma. Brahma, every living being is Brahma. But the Supreme Living Being, or the Supreme Personality of God, is the Supreme Brahma, or Supreme Living Being. And Param Dhamma means He is the Supreme Rest of everything. And Pavitram means He is pure from material contamination, and his address at Purusam. Purusam means the supreme enjoyer. Sasatam. Sasatam means from very beginning. He is the first person. Dibbam, transcendental. Deva, the supreme personality of Godhead. Ajam, never born. Vibho, the greatest. Now, one may doubt that because Krishna was the friend of Arjuna, therefore he might say all these things to his own friend. But Arjuna, just to drive out this kind of doubt in the mind of the readers of Bhagavad Gita, he establishes his proposition by the authorities. He says that Lord Sri Krishna is accepted as the Supreme Personality of Godhead not only by himself, Arjuna, but he is so accepted by authorities like Narada, Asita, Devala, Vyasa. These personalities are great personalities in distributing the Vedic knowledge. They are accepted by all acharyas. Therefore, Arjuna says that whatever you have spoken so far to me, I accept them as completely perfect. Sarvameta ritangamanni, I take it, I believe it, that whatever you have spoken, they are all right. And your personality of Godhead is very difficult to understand. And therefore, you cannot be known by even the demigods. You cannot be known even by the demigods. That means the Supreme Personality Godhead cannot be known even by greater personalities than the human being, and how a human being can understand Sri Krishna without becoming his devotee. Therefore, Bhagavad Gita should be taken up in the spirit of devotee of Lord Sri Krishna. One should not think that he is equal on the same level of Sri Krishna, or one should not think that he is an ordinary personality, maybe a very great personality. No. Lord Sri Krishna is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So, at least theoretically, on the statement of Bhagavad Gita, or on the statement assertion of Arjuna, the person who is trying to understand Bhagavad Gita, we should accept Sri Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and then with that submissive spirit, unless one receives this Bhagavad Gita in a submissive spirit and oral reception, it is very difficult to understand Bhagavad Gita, because it is a great mystery. So, in this Bhagavad Gita, we may survey what is this Bhagavad Gita. This Bhagavad Gita is meant for delivering persons from the nuisance of this material existence. Every man is in difficulty in so many ways, and as Arjuna also was in difficulty in the matter of fighting the battle of Kurukshetra, and as such he surrendered unto Sri Krishna, and therefore this Bhagavad Gita was spoken. Similarly, not only Arjuna, but every one of us is always full of anxieties due to our this material existence. Asadgraha. It is our existence is in the environment or atmosphere of non-existence. But actually, we are not non-existent. Our existence is eternal. But somewhere or other, we are put into this asat. Asat means which does not exist. Now, out of so many human beings who are actually inquiring about his position as to what he is, why he is put into this awkward position of suffering, unless one is awakened to this position, that why I am suffering, I do not want all these sufferings. I have tried to make a solution of all these sufferings, but I have failed. Unless one is in that position, he is not to be considered a perfect human being. Humanity begins when this sort of inquiries are awakened in one's mind. In the Brahma Sutra, this inquiry is called Brahma Jigyasa. Adhatu Brahma Jigyasa. And every activity of a human being is to be considered a failure without having this inquiry in his mind. So, persons who have awakened this inquiry into his mind as to what I am, why I am suffering, where from I have come, or where I shall go after death. When these inquiries come and awaken in the mind of a sane human being, then he is practically the right student for understanding Bhagavad Gita, and he must be Siddhava. Siddhava, he must have a respect, a firm respect in the Supreme Personality of God. Such a person, as the ideal person was Arjuna. So Lord Krishna, he descends. Yadā-yadā hi dharmasya glāni bhavati. Just to establish the real purpose of life, when man forgets the real purpose of life, the mission of human form of life, then it is called dharmasya glāni, disturbance of the occupation of human being. So, in that circumstances, out of many, many human beings who awakens, one who awakens the spirit of understanding his position, for him this Bhagavad Gita is spoken. We are just like swallowed by the tigress of missiles, and Lord being causelessly merciful upon the living entities, especially for the human being, he spoke Bhagavad Gita, making his friend Arjuna as the student. Arjuna was certainly being an associate of Lord Krishna. He was above all ignorance, but still Arjuna was put into ignorance in the battlefield of Kurukshetra, just to question about the problems of life to the Supreme Lord, so that the Lord can explain them for the benefit of future generation of human beings, to chalk out the plan of his life and act in that way, so that his life, his mission of human life can be perfect. So in this Bhagavad Gita, the subject matter is comprehending five different truths. The first truth is what is God? It is the preliminary study of the science of God. So, that science of God is explained here. Next, the constitutional position of the living entities, jiva, Ishara and jiva. The Lord, the Supreme Lord, is called Ishara. Ishvara means controller. And jiva, the living entities, and the jivas, the living entities, they are not Ishvara or the controller. They are controlled. Artificially, if I say that I am not controlled, I am free, this is not the sign of a sane man. A living being is controlled in every respect. At least in his conditioned life, he is controlled. So, in this Bhagavad Gita, the subject matter comprehends about the Ishvara, the supreme controller, and about the controlled living entities, and prakriti, the nature, the material nature, and next, the time, the duration of existence of the whole universe, or this manifestation of the material nature, and the duration of time, or the eternal time, and karma. Karma means activity. Everything, the whole universe, whole manifestation, cosmic manifestation, is full of different activities. The living being, especially, they are all engaged in different activities. So we have to study from the Bhagavad Gita, Ishvara, what is God, jiva, what are these living entities, and prakriti, what is this cosmic manifestation, and how it is controlled by time, and what are these activities. Now, out of these five subject matter, in the Bhagavad Gita, it is established that the Supreme Godhead, or Krishna, or Brahma, or Paramatma, you may call whatever you like, but the Supreme Controller, there is a Supreme Controller. So, the Supreme Controller is the greatest of all. And the living beings, they are in quality like the Supreme Controller. Just like the Supreme Controller, the Lord, He has control over the universal affairs, over the material nature, how it will be explained in the later chapters of Bhagavad Gita, that this material nature is not independent. She is acting under the direction of the Supreme Lord. Mayadhyakshena prakriti suyate sacharacharam. This material nature is working under my direction, mayadhyakshena, under my superintendence. So, we are mistaken when we see wonderful things happening in the cosmic nature. We should know that behind these wonderful manifestations, there is a controller. Nothing can be manifested without being controlled. It is childish to not to consider about the controller just like a very nice motor car with very good speed and very good engineering arrangement is running on this street. A child may think that how this motor car is running without the help of any horse or any pulling agent. But a sane man or an elderly person, he knows that in spite of all engineering arrangements in the motor car, without the driver it cannot move. That engineering arrangement of a motor car or an electric powerhouse, now at the present moment it is the day of machinery. But we should always know that behind the machinery, behind the wonderful working of the machinery, there is a driver. So the Supreme Lord is the driver, adhyaksha. He is the supreme personality under whose direction everything is working. Now, these jiva, or the living entities, they have been accepted by the Lord in this Bhagavad Gita, as we'll know it in later chapters, that they are parts and parcels of the Supreme Lord. Mamaivamsa jiva-bhuta. Ansa means parts and parcels. Now, as a particle of gold is also particle, a drop of water of the ocean is also salty. Similarly, we, the living entities, being part and parcels of the Supreme Controller, Ishvara, Bhagavan, or Lord Sri Krishna, we have got, qualitatively, all the qualities of the Supreme Lord in mind. Because we are minute Ishvara, subordinate Ishvara. We are also trying to control. We are just trying to control over the nature. In the present days, you are trying to control over the space. You are trying to float imitation planets. So this tendency of controlling or creating is there because partially we have got that controlling tendency. But we should know that this tendency is not sufficient. We have the tendency of controlling over the material nature, lording it over the material nature. But we are not the supreme controller. That thing is explained in the Bhagavad Gita. Then, what is this material nature? The nature is also explained. The nature, material nature, is explained in the Bhagavad Gita as inferior prakriti. Inferior prakriti and the living entities are explained as the superior prakriti. Prakriti means which is controlled, which is under prakriti. Real meaning of prakriti is a woman or a female. Just like a husband controls the activities of his wife. Similarly, the prakriti is also a subordinate predominated. The Lord, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is the predominator, and this Prakriti, both the living entities and the material nature, they are different Prakritis, or predominated, controlled by the Supreme. So, according to Bhagavad Gita, the living entities, although they are parts and parcels of the Supreme Lord, they are taken as Prakriti. It is clearly mentioned in the 7th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, yes, aparayam, itasu vidhi apara. This material nature is aparayam. Itasu, and beyond this, there is another Prakriti. And what is that Prakriti? Jiva-bhuta. So, this Prakriti, the constitution of this Prakriti is constituted by three qualities. The mode of goodness, the mode of passion, and mode of ignorance. And about these modes, three different kinds of modes, goodness, passion, and ignorance, there is eternal time. And by combination of these modes of nature and under the control, under the purview of this eternal time, there are activities which is called karma. These activities are being done from time immemorial, and we are suffering or enjoying the fruits of our activities. Just like in the present life also, we enjoy the activities, the fruits of our activities. Suppose I am a businessman and I have worked very hard with intelligence, and I have amassed a vast amount of bank balance. Now I am the enjoyer. Similarly, suppose I start in my business with a vast amount of money, but I failed to make it successful, I lost all the money, so I am a sufferer. So similarly, in every field of life, we enjoy the result of our work. This is called karma. So these things, Ishara, Jiva, Prakriti, or the Supreme Lord, or the living entity, the material nature, the eternal time, and our different activities. These things are explained in the Bhagavad Gita. Now, out of these five, the Lord, the living entities, and the material nature, and time, these four items are eternal. Now, manifestation of Prakriti may be temporary, but it is not false. Some philosophers say that this manifestation of material nature is false. But according to the philosophy of Bhagavad Gita, or according to the philosophy of the Vaishnavas, they do not accept the manifestation of the world as false. they accept that the manifestation is real, but it is temporary. It is just like a cloud takes place in the sky and the rainy season begins. And after the rainy season, there are so many new green vegetation all over the field we can see. And as soon as the rainy season is finished, then the cloud is vanquished, generally, gradually, all this vegetation dry up and again the land becomes barren. Similarly, this material manifestation takes place at a certain interval. We will understand it, we will know it from the pages of the Bhagavad Gita. Bhutta bhutta praliyate. These manifestations becomes magnificent at a certain interval, and again it disappears. That is the work of the prakriti. But it is working eternally. That prakriti is eternal. It is not false. Because the Lord has accepted mama prakriti, my prakriti. Aparayam itastu vidhi me prakriti param. Bhinna prakriti. Bhinna prakriti, apara prakriti. This material nature is a separated energy of the Supreme Lord and the living entities. They are also energy of the Supreme Lord, but they are not separated. They are eternally related. So, the Lord, the living entity, the nature, material nature, and time, they are all eternal. But the other item, karma, is not eternal. The effects of karma or activity may be very old. We are suffering or enjoying the results of our activities from a time immemorial. But still we can change the result of our karma or activity. That will depend on our perfect knowledge. We are engaged in various activities, undoubtedly. But we do not know what sort of activities we shall adopt that will give us relief from the actions and reactions of all activities. That is also explained in the Bhagavad Gita. Now, the position of Ishvara is a supreme consciousness. Position of Ishvara or the Supreme Lord is supreme consciousness. And the jivas or the living entities, being parts and parcels of the Supreme Lord, he is also conscious. A living entity is also conscious. The living entity is explained as prakriti, energy, and the material nature is also explained as prakriti, but amongst the two, one prakriti, the jivas, they are conscious, the other prakriti is not conscious. That is the difference. Therefore, the jiva prakriti is called superior because the jiva has consciousness similar to the Lord. The Lord is supreme consciousness. One should not claim that a jiva, a living entity, is also supremely conscious. No. A living being cannot be supremely conscious at any stage of his perfection. This is a misleading theory. This is misleading theory. But he is conscious, that's all. But he is not supreme conscious. The supreme conscious, it will be explained in the Bhagavad Gita, in the chapter where the distinction between the jiva and Ishvara is explained, khetra khetragya. This khetragya has been explained that the Lord is also khetragya or conscious, and the jivas or the living beings, they are also conscious. But the difference is that a living being is conscious within his limited body, but the Lord is conscious of all bodies. Ishvara sarvabhutanam riddhesha arjuna tishtati. The Lord lives within the core of heart in every living being. Therefore, he is conscious of the psychic movements, activities of the Lord, of the particular jiva. We should not forget, it is also explained that the Paramatma, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is living in everyone's heart as Ishvara, as the controller. And he is giving direction. He is giving direction. Sarvasya chaham hridi sannivishtya. Everyone's heart he is situated, and he gives direction to act as he desires. The living entity forgets what to do. First of all, he makes his determination to act in a certain way, and then he is entangled in the actions and reactions of his own karma. But after giving up one type of body, when he enters another type of body, just like we give up one kind of dress, one type of dress for another type of dress. Similarly, it is explained in this Bhagavad Gita that vāsāṃsi jinnāni jathāvihāya. One, as one changes his different dresses, similarly, the living entities, they are also changing different bodies, transmigration of the soul, and pulling on the actions and reactions of his past activities. So these activities can be changed when a living being is in the mode of goodness, in sanity, and he understands what sort of activities he should adopt. And if he does so, then the whole actions and reactions of his past activities can be changed. Therefore, karma is not eternal. Other things, out of the five items, Ishvara, jiva, prakriti, kala, and karma, these four items are eternal, whereas the karma, the item known as karma, that is not eternal. Now, the conscious Ishvara, the supreme conscious Ishvara, and the difference between the supreme conscious Ishvara, the Lord, and the living being is, in the present circumstances, is like this. Consciousness of both of the Lord and the living entities, they are, this consciousness is transcendent. It is not that this consciousness is generated by the association of this matter. That is a mistaken idea. the theory that consciousness develops under certain circumstances of material combination is not accepted in the Bhagavad Gita. We cannot. Consciousness may be pervertedly reflected by the cover of material circumstances, just like light reflected through a colored glass may seem according to the color. Similarly, the consciousness of Lord, it is not materially affected. The Supreme Lord, just like Krishna, where he says that maya dhakkhena prakriti, when he descends in this material world, his consciousness is not materially affected. Had his consciousness been materially affected, he was unfit to speak about the transcendental subject matter in the Bhagavad Gita. One cannot say anything about the transcendental world without being free from the materially contaminated consciousness. So the Lord was not materially contaminated. But our consciousness at the present moment is materially contaminated. So whole thing, as the Bhagavad Gita teaches, we have to purify the materially contaminated consciousness. And in that pure consciousness, the actions will be done. That will make us happy. We cannot stop. We cannot stop our activity. The activities are to be purified. And these purified activities are called bhakti. Bhakti means they appear also just like ordinary activity, but they are not contaminated activities. They are purified activities. So an ignorant person may see that a devotee is working like an ordinary man, but a person with poor fund of knowledge, he does not know that the activities of a devotee or the activities of the Lord, they are not contaminated by the impure consciousness of matter, the impurity of the three gunas, modes of nature, the transcendental consciousness. So our consciousness is materially contaminated, we should know. Now, when we are such materially contaminated, that is called our condition stage. And the false ego, the false consciousness,